Get this going. Let's go. And here we go. Welcome to Inside the 18, live from my bunker in Palm Desert, California, still known as my dad's guest room. I'm Michael Magid. With me is 99 World Cup winner Saskia Weber, Instagram celebrity Omar Zini, also known
and
as
greatest goalkeeper coach ever.
And greatest goalkeeper coach in the world, Saskia.
That'll never go away.
Oh, I think that's just going to last for the entire thing. And joining us today, because we need more star power here, we have PSG goalkeeper Ariana Cristione. Did I say that right?
I gave it a shot.
Ariana, this is awesome. I'm really excited to have you here. It's not often that we get somebody that literally, like you mentioned, where they play, and like even my dad knows where that is. Like that's a big deal. Guys, by the way, we are Facebook Live right now on Facebook Live at Goalkeeper Podcast. If you're watching this right now with your friends, start a watch party. Let's get some comments going in the comment section right now. We're all going to share it with people on our feeds. Just let everybody know we want to get as many people on this as possible for right now. And then, of course, we're obviously going to put it up later on. And before we start, I also want to say thank you to everybody for the GoFundMe. We had a little GoFundMe. Ariana, Omar had a little situation with his computer equipment that ended up no longer being usable anymore. And as we all know, this has been a challenging time for us goalkeeper coaches. Omar, like I said, is known as Pro GK Academy, and he provides a lot of free, great content out there to the goalkeeping community. And the goalkeeping community came to his aid to help him continue doing his freelance work, which is basically, you know, what's keeping him afloat right now. So raised over $2,500. Shout out to everybody in the GK Union for doing that. I know Omar's getting a little shy about this. Just to all let everybody know, he didn't start it, and he was a little embarrassed when it happened, but everybody, you know, we all have these situations, man, and we just wanted to see you get back to work, you know. So
I appreciate that. No, I want to thank everybody that donated, everybody that reached out, and it was a weird time. Definitely weird times for everybody, but a weird time for me just because my main source of creating content was gone, and about 9 days of just being, I was literally watching Hell's Kitchen for 9 straight days, doing nothing and posting old content. So I learned a lot from Gordon Ramsay and how to really command respect from a brigade and learned a lot. So
I'm a Chopped girl. I'm not Hell's Kitchen. I'm a Chopped girl.
Is that the one? That's the one where the they give you just random things and
the
you have
baskets,
to like.
Right? Yeah. So now every time I cook, I'll walk out into the dining room and be like, "What I'm presenting to you today is," and I break down the food.
Smart.
Ariana, do you ever do that? Do you ever just take like 4 different things from the refrigerator and go like, "Well, I'm gonna make something with this"?
That's what I usually do, to be honest.
Of course.
But to be fair, I'm a pretty good cook. At least my fiance will tell you that. He's stoked every night. But and I come from an Italian family, so I can make a pasta with anything in the fridge.
It sounds like something that we're looking forward to for
challenge.
When Ariana comes to Cal South again.
Challenge.
We're gonna have to have some of this pasta, and we'll have to live stream that. We have to live stream that to the audience and do a taste test like a food show. Omar, are you in for that?
Well, Omar's just going to yell at everybody and command respect after watching Gordon Ramsay. He's like, "Get out of my kitchen!"
It's insane.
It's insane. Raw.
I'm having PTSD right now thinking about all the yelling I've seen him do.
Omar, how much longer is Ramadan?
We have 2 more weeks. So we started 2 weeks ago, 2 Fridays ago. So now we got about 2 more weeks left.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, moving by pretty fast.
Man, it's got to be moving by faster for you than it is. Actually, for you, it probably moves by slower than it does for me.
It's weird. I wake up, I have my breakfast like 4 in the morning, and then go back to sleep, wake up, do work, and then I nap, and then I wait till like 7:45, and we eat. So it's a weird schedule.
Yeah, then I did an Instagram live with like some UK brand at like 3 in the morning or something like that?
No, I did it like at 10 a.m. today, but he stayed up later for me, but it was nice.
That like Ariana's doing for us right now.
Yes.
Yeah. It's not so late.
No, it's a, you know, Yeah, that's true. 9:30, 10 o'clock. I mean, we're not all, you know, ancient yet.
I was. You were texting me last night at 9:30. I was in bed. I was like, what?
There's such a difference between the woke, completely awake and going at it day Saskia Weber and the I am shutting down for the evening.
Absolutely.
Saskia.
The text responses
in the daytime are like 4 pages long, and then like at night it's like cool.
Okay.
Great.
Okay.
Oh, fun. Okay.
It's true.
By the way, speaking of fun, thank you for everybody who's been rating, reviewing, and subscribing on the podcast. We've been trying to not read the reviews on when we have big guests, but we have this review right now that we kind of have to read on the air right now. So I'm just going to read this one. This comes from this random person who goes by AC Football, and they say, useful and entertaining. All goalkeepers can relate to this podcast. I only recently stumbled across this and wish it could have accompanied me on more of my runs. I found myself nodding my head and relating to a lot of the examples the hosts give. Strongly recommend it for youth goalkeepers and field players. Can definitely learn a thing or two and be entertained at the same time. Keep the episodes coming. 3 exclamation points. That mystery person is Ariana Criscione, and that's why we were reading that review.
I love it.
On the air right now. So shout out to all our fans in France right here. That was very sweet of you. And I wanted to share that because, honestly, it's really cool when we get these reviews. And it's honestly when people such as yourself at a high level respect what we do, enjoy what we do. It means a lot to us because it makes us think like, you know, maybe we're doing something right. Maybe we are giving back to the community the right way. So thank you for that.
It was totally honest. I mean, every word of it. I really do enjoy it. And there was definitely a lot of moments. Saskia, you have quite a few where I'm literally running and I'm like, oh my God, yeah, that totally happened to me too.
I'm known as the opinionated bee and some other things, but it's okay. I love it. I love that I almost stopped you in your tracks.
By the way, your hair game is solid today, Sauce.
It's a nightmare.
It's a nightmare.
It's nightmare.
It's good. It's good. I like it like this.
If the screen was closer, you'd see the gray. I need a Brazilian blowout. I need color. That's BG song, sorry. You're a little too old for that, young for that. You guys all froze. No, it is what it is. That's why I usually have a hat on. I was trying to give some, I knew Ariana was on today, so I wanted to look a little nicer.
Oh.
That's the thing, Ariana. Paris is like the fashion capital, right? So, and then you're Italian too. You got, you know, all of Italy and they're all fashionable. So, you know, we had
Milan.
Yeah, look at me. I embrace
my pets or spandex and sweatshirt a lot.
He's just saying it because I took a baseball hat off today.
I really like that soccer mom of Newport Beach look a lot. You know, like a cute little workout top. It's kind of my go-to. Talks about quarantine and how they're dressing. I'm like, no, it's kind of my everyday look.
All right, guys. Well, let's get into today's topic. This is something that all three of us had said that we really wanted to discuss in the future, and we were always just trying to find the right vehicle to discuss it. And I came across some of your work as a journalist, some of the papers that you've written, and it really made me think about what Saskia and I had literally had this conversation about a week ago in regarding inclusion and representation in the goalkeeping world. You know, one thing personally that I found is that a lot of people, they just assume because the game of soccer is a very world game that it'd be the same case in the goalkeeping community. And I've honestly found a lot of times that there's been a lack of representation in the goalkeeping community. So, Ariana, for people who are out there listening who might not be familiar with the terms of inclusion, may not be the social justice warriors that we are here, what is inclusion?
I mean, there's probably quite a few different definitions of inclusion, and I'm by no means a university professor to give you a great explanation, but for me it's just giving the opportunity, the platform for more people to be involved and for everybody to have a voice in what's happening.
Yeah. I think you just put it succinctly right there. One of the great things I love about this show here is that we showcase that the goalkeeping community is people from all different walks of life, all different cultures. We try to pride ourselves on having different types of voices on the show consistently. I mean, even we were just talking recently just about Omar and Ramadan, you know, regarding his Muslim faith. You know, Saskia has a different, you know, story than myself. And I think that's really, really important. So Saskia, I know you're a little opinionated.
Oh, my story's crazy.
I know your stories. So let's just be straight up honest, guys. Either Omar or Saskia, like who's generally represented the goalkeeping community? And I'm primarily talking about off the field. I'm talking about on coaches and, you know, and making decisions front office wise and stuff like that.
Omar. I mean, ever since I got into coaching, the coaching side of things, I've noticed the English influence, English and European influence. And I think a lot of them, from what I've gathered, is that they come here for college, and if they don't get into professional level of playing, they get into coaching. And from the top down, you see Phil Weddin, Paul Rogers, both English guys, and they've had a very significant pulse on where the goalkeeper position has gone here in the United States. So I feel like it's very European-centric and everything that we do. Not to say that that is wrong, but in terms of inclusion and in terms of understanding that we have a lot of great American coaches here, and they also have great voices. And for me, at least, to get those guys who are maybe even foreigners, but coaching in the MLS, get them some more respect, because people think of, oh, you're a goalkeeper coach in the MLS, probably don't know as much as somebody in the EPL, when really not much separates somebody like Chris Sharp from someone like Andrew Sparks. Very similar. I'm sure they probably know a lot of the same people. They know a lot of the same information, but obviously resources, you know, the name, the badge, and who they are puts them at a higher pedestal in terms of like the perception of people. So for me, at least in terms of inclusion, for me, it's been trying to get the American goalkeeper coach and the American goalkeeper, put them on a platform as well, to show them that we're not much different, and we know a lot as well, and that we can actually provide a lot of great information to not just goalkeepers in America, but to goalkeepers all around the world.
Hey, see, you're over in Europe, and you've been in Europe for the majority of your career, and you've seen kind of both sides. You know, what are your thoughts on some of the things that Omar just said?
No, I mean, I absolutely agree with what Omar said. Looking at this question a little earlier, the same thought absolutely came to my mind, especially growing up in the United States. Anytime you were at camps, most of the time at camps, there was always one or two English people, and just because they had the accent, that automatically elevated their status as like a coach. Like, had to be good. And parents almost needed that in order to, oh yeah, that totally like certifies this camp or this club, because there's English people there, so they have to know what they're doing. And I can honestly say that's not always the case.
Yeah, I agree, but I think it's ignorant and stupid when you look at the success of our goalkeepers throughout the years, our American goalkeepers in the European game, in the EPL and everything like that. We want one of our greatest exports for soccer has been goalkeepers, whether it's Brad, Casey, Timmy, and down the line. And so obviously our goalkeeper coaches here are doing something right. And I get it. And I totally agree with you, Ariana. Like, it's like that, oh, well, you know, they're Dutch, they're English, no offense, Franz, they're Dutch, they're English and everything like that. Like, they must be better. They must know it better. But obviously, you know, we're doing something right. And even on the women's side of things, look at the success of our goalkeepers here. And, you know, coming from Paul Blagic, coming from Tim Mulqueen and Tony DiCicco and everything, like, that's my success. And, you know, and a lot of other goalkeepers. So we have to take, the world has to take a step back and realize, you know, our goalkeeper coaches here know what they're doing at a higher level. Some don't. but you know, we do have our finger on the pulse.
But that's something that I think is just in regards to, I love the fact you brought up the ignorance factor, because I think a lot of times it's a presentation by people on the way that they perceive something, because of that's how they've been told that's what's good or that's what's bad.
Well, I mean, look at even the inclusion of like Latin American coaches and stuff like that. Like, that's a struggle, you know, across the board. And is it because we have like kind of typecast them in the sense that, you know, Latin American players only play a certain way and their goalkeepers are flamboyant and only play a certain way, and so the coaches are like that? Is that what we're saying? And so you know, why isn't that inclusion across the board? I mean, look at, you know, the amount of, you know, Mexican Americans in this country and stuff like that, that have such a rich history in soccer. Like, why aren't they prevalent in the Federation? Why aren't they around, you know? And so are we saying, well, no, is that what Europe does to us? And then we're doing it down the line.
Yeah. Omar, I want to bring this up to you because you're of a multicultural background. You know, obviously, you know, you've got the two completely different backgrounds, you know, in regards to the, the Mexican and the Iranian, but, Lebanese. Yeah, I was close. Man, I need a class on inclusion.
Oh, you're
right,
going to get some hate.
I'm getting some, especially since we went to a Lebanese restaurant in Orlando.
You are so going to get some texts.
That was delicious, by the way. Have you found it difficult to present yourself as a quote unquote goalkeeping, I don't want to say expert, but somebody that's prominent in the goalkeeping community because of your background?
I wouldn't say it's because of my background. I mean, I think early on, I figured I needed to create leverage for myself because I didn't play professionally. So I needed to find a way to, within the system, figure out a way to put myself in a position that I had the platform and that people would respect me. I knew stuff about goalkeeping, but I also needed to figure out a way to present that without, anybody saying, oh, he doesn't know this, he doesn't know that. So I needed to make sure the content that I posted was good, the way I packaged it, the network that I created and how I made everything look aesthetically, but also to where I created the platform so that I can command that respect. To answer your question, would I probably have gone a little bit further by this point if I had an English accent? Yes. I mean, you think about that in anywhere you go in the world. If you, like, for example, this is something random, but I was watching on ESPN, they had NBA TV, and they had an English commentator on this show for basketball.
Oh, I want to watch that. That sounds amazing.
But to me, I heard it and I was just like, I think from whatever we were taught and whatever we've seen in our entire lives in terms of journalism and like broadcasting, that I was like, there's no way an English person should be speaking about basketball. And then vice versa, I'm watching like a broadcast and I'm listening to like someone like Thomas Rongen. And I'm like, God, this guy just like, I can't listen to his voice and watch this game. I just can't. It has to be an English accent. Like for some reason, that's just where my mind has gone. So maybe it's just like this innate, like we kind of grew up on it and it's just been, you know, forced into us. But yes, if it comes down to it, I think if I had an English accent, I probably would be further along because you probably get a little bit more upfront
respect.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's totally ridiculous and wrong. You know, why can't an English person understand basketball, football, or any baseball or whatever? It's ridiculous. And agreed, so if you look at it and look at Fox Sports, look at ESPN, everybody, all their female hosts of their soccer shows are English, which there's nothing wrong with whatsoever, but I'm pretty sure I can name a bunch of other hosts that are American that could do just as good. But it automatically sets up this legitimacy of, well, they're English, they know what they're talking about, it's, you know, European football and stuff like that. But, you know, that's the establishment making that decision. That's not grounded in anything, in my opinion.
Historical reasoning behind it, one, because people, well, it, the game for some, because the rules were invented in England, they say it originated in England, even though there's proof that it's been in other places also. Playing with the ball on your foot has been historically shown in other countries. But also, I think it goes back to the Sky Sports deal that was made for the English Premier League, that was one of the first to really broadcast internationally. And I think coming into people's homes and seeing the English league, that's why it's so big in Scandinavia. Scandinavian people meet one who likes football and they have a tattoo of Liverpool, Manchester United, or somebody else on their body, most likely. But I think it really goes into that. And so people, their first images of soccer was coming with these accents, and that's just, it's been instilled and over and over and over.
Absolutely. Like,
the media is just prolonging it by proving, okay, they know what they're doing. We've been doing it for so long that we're all so used to hearing it in the US that when we don't, we're like freaked out.
I straight up.
It can't be as good. Like, no, and I totally agree. I 100% agree with you. Trust me. Absolutely.
Saskia and Ariana, I have a question for you guys. I feel like, for example, you see a lot of guys, you know, or girls, and they get to that next level, and obviously, when their career is over, they think about, you know, where, what's the next step. And if they want to get into broadcasting, great. So for example, Saskia, I see a lot of the 99ers on TV when it comes to women's soccer, and I see them a lot of the times. And I again, I don't know if this is something that you guys plan, but something also that, like, okay, you're on this great team who won the World Cup. Now all these doors are now open, and now you've kind of stepped away from the normal human being into a select group of people that get opportunities because of your resume. And Ariana, for you, having PSG in your resume, in your background, now you can pretty much go anywhere, throw that name around, and now it's in your favor. So have you guys feel like your opinions have shifted once you've kind of stepped into the select group of people?
I mean, for me, I have a big mouth, so I've never been afraid to raise.
Me too.
I think we got two of them right here.
PSG just allows me for people to actually stop and maybe listen more, but regularly I've never been afraid to say my opinion or do what I want, so I'll knock on doors all day long. Probably, I'm not at the point where my career is over that all these doors have opened up now because of the badge behind you. It's still very pretty. I'm sure it does help. There is one part of it, though, that I'd like to add on to that, though. I think it's amazing that a lot of people are going into broadcasting. I don't think, though, just because you're a great player, you should automatically jump into broadcasting in any sport. We've seen a lot of people. Your voice isn't prepared for it. You're not prepared for it. It's not easy. It's not just magically because you understand football and you can talk about it technically. Broadcasting is where you should be going. I think there's also other avenues that, unfortunately, have also been closed to the players where they just didn't know were there, that they could be making more of a difference, especially in the development of the game.
I 100% agree with you, and I'm going to get in trouble for this. And you know where I'm going, Michael. I 100% agree with you because, you know, just because you were a top player and a great player doesn't mean you come across on television, period. No. I mean, after soccer, I went in and I hosted a television show. It had nothing to do with soccer or anything like that. But, like, you know, I have a big mouth. I'm comfortable in front of the camera and stuff like that. I watch certain goalkeepers, analysts.
Oh, I know where you're going with this. I know exactly where you're going with this. I think everybody here knows where you're going with this.
I'm not sure I know officials. I think I can.
All right, look, I love you. You're a Jersey boy and everything like that. But, you know, Timmy Howard is not that engaging on television. I'm sorry. And
oh, I thought you were going a different direction.
No.
Tony's good.
I thought you were going to HS.
No,
that's where I thought it.
No, but we've talked about that, Michael. Like, it's just there is a certain type of like charisma. There's a certain type of like getting your words out there with authority, with everything. Not everybody can do it just because you have a resume behind you of your success as a goalkeeper. Period.
Sasha, cool question. Oh, go ahead.
To doing a completely different job, and I think that goes into the. What you were saying, Omar, that you weren't a professional player, so you didn't have as much street cred behind you trying to coach. People didn't know what you were doing. Unfortunately, I know a lot of pro goalkeepers, even in the men's game, especially over here, that once they're done, they want to work for one of the clubs that they used to play for or something else. They're not the greatest coaches by any means.
Absolutely.
Don't just become a coach because you knew how to play.
For sure.
Absolutely. And we talked about that a couple of weeks ago. We said, you know, there's a fundamental difference between understanding how to coach soccer and teach soccer to just because you play. And people don't realize that difference, especially with goalkeeping. They're just like, oh, you know, so-and-so played at this school, they'll be our goalkeeper coach. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't. You have to understand the game. And I'm still learning. And I've talked about that. Like, I'm still learning every day from my field coaches, from everything. And, you know, I can tell you right away when I came in, like if somebody handed me a full team, I would have not known what to do with it. And, you know, yes, I can coach goalkeepers and stuff, but it takes practice and it takes, I talk to Blodge. I talk to my other coaches. I ask about things. I constantly am learning and researching because not unlike Omar, I am not the best goalkeeper coach in the history of the world. And I have to keep learning.
I want to bring this back, and we're talking about the goalkeeping tip right here. Why is it this position especially has been late to the game in regards to looking at the non-traditional, for lack of a better term, options when it comes to coaching? And by the way, I want to talk about the female element too, because Saskia and I, we talked about that. Just the lack of representation in goalkeeping from women in coaching. And I think a lot of it has to do with just a lot of, you know, people need to see, more girls need to see an AC and an Saskia and everything to know that they can do things outside of just being a player. And I think that's really an issue that we still have in our country.
Can I jump in on this one, though, really quick?
Sure. So,
it's your show.
Yeah, it's your show.
Guys, a show, but on inclusion, I just think sometimes women fall to the wayside and you don't even think about it because you don't see it enough. And I am so sorry, Omar, but I'm going to throw you under the bus right now, and I apologize.
Sure.
But I would have an Instagram account, and I'm pretty sure it's yours, the BroGK Academy.
Yes.
Right, that's it. You have to scroll for 4 pages before you see a female.
Yeah.
And you and I don't think you absolutely probably didn't do it on purpose. It's just like you had images, or you had interesting clips, or you like were inundated with information. And there's just not that much about women goalkeepers out there. But unfortunately, if you're a little girl and you go to that page and you're looking and you're trying to look up to a role model, you wouldn't see it unless you kept scrolling. And I think we need it to be, you know, 1 per page or a shorter distance that younger female goalkeepers are able to look up to somebody, and that, and with inclusion, it could be a female, a person of color, different religion, like a bunch of stuff going on, which is obviously, you don't have like necessarily time to search out all of those things for each one of your pages, but it should be more easily accessible to find those images.
For sure.
The information.
No, I would agree. I think that's, like you said, it's kind of like what comes at me, and maybe the way I've put in terms of like the information that I gather in, majority of it is, you know, Major League Soccer, USL, like stuff, content that I can like post without like copyright infringement. So like that. And then I have, you know, the Premier League and stuff like that. So I definitely need to, and Mike and I have discussed this, promote more. I've done a good amount when the NWSL was in season last year. I posted probably like 1 a week, but I think it could be a little bit more, because you're right. I think that's, as much as I wished I had seen more content growing up, I'm sure the women, I mean, there's like another layer of that too, where like there's young girls out there who don't get to see. I mean, there's more goalkeepers in this world than Hope Solo, I'll tell you that. There's a lot more goalkeepers out there than just one goalkeeper who gets highlighted on every single page, which is Hope Solo. So I promise you this, I will do my part, and I will try to continue to grow that a little bit more.
I can't wait for Saskia's response here, because she's like got her hand up, like she can't wait to get...
No, you know, oh God. No, and I agree. Like, I'll take the spotlight off Omar for a second. And I thought that was an absolutely great point. But I think it's ingrained. I think it's, and I'm not be calling you misogynistic or anything like that. I think it's just a natural thing. Okay, like go on Instagram and stuff like that, and US soccer, not US men's national team, but US soccer will post top 10 greatest US soccer players of all time. And all 10 are men. Okay? Automatically, all 10 are men. It's not the men's national team site. It's not the women's national team site. It's US soccer site. And top 10 players of all time. Men, 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 men. Apparently, yeah. We've forgotten about the NEAMs and everybody else in the world. Like, maybe because they would dominate the list. Okay? I don't know. But that's an automatic thought. Okay, I'm promoting soccer, U.S. soccer's promoting soccer, top 10 goal scorers of all time. Well, we all know no man will make that list. It would be all women. And maybe they said top 10 men's national team, but they don't do that. It's an automatic, I'm thinking of this, men, 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 men. And I think it goes without like really thinking about, you know, it does. And I totally agree with you. You know, like,
or... But the difference too, and especially even in different languages and on different sites, it'll say top 10 players and it'll only be the men. And for it to be the women, there has to be the word women.
Exactly.
Put into it.
Exactly. Exactly.
And the US is positive because the US does associate the US men's national team and they call it the US men's national team.
Right.
But if you're in France and you say the French national team, it's the men. If you're in Italy and you say the Italian national team, it's the men. Right. You have to add women in order for them to understand who you're talking about.
Right. You know, that's just a cultural change. It's going to take a long time to shift that mentality. Sorry, it is.
But that's why I love like, you know, on Monday when we had Aline on, you know, Aline Heiss, you know, who plays in Tenerife and for the Brazilian national team and is also a goalkeeper coach. I think young girls like Isabel, you know, who, you know, and I don't want to put you on blast here, Isabel, but you were so excited because you're like, I see Aline, I see myself. I see somebody that I can roll myself after as I want to be a coach. I want to be a player. And I see somebody doing all those things. And that we need more of that. We really, really need more of that. I've tried to hire a lot of female coaches. And a lot of times one of the issues that just simply happens is they don't continue on. And it's really disappointing to me because I think we miss out on a lot of great teachers in the game because people aren't giving them the opportunities. I mean, and they deserve that.
Yeah, but let's be honest. The opportunities are few and far between. The money sucks. Like, let's be honest. The money sucks unless you have a major title and a major name. And the money still sucks, I'm telling you right now. But you know, when you have the opportunity across the board, so many clubs, so many men's this, men's that, and the other. And for women, it's few and far between. And when they're done playing, it's what's my choice? Do I go with my education and I go on to be a Ronnie Fair, a surgeon? Or do I come with, you know, a great mental game? Do I go and coach? And it's just like, I got to raise a family. I got to do this stuff. It's different. I'm sorry. It's different. And I'm not saying men's goalkeeper coaches make a ton of money either, but I think on average across the board, it's a sustainable situation as opposed to women, few and far between, not so much. So
but I want to bring up one thing real quick, Omar, before you bring that up. Saskia, I love the fact that when you got the job at UCLA, one of the boys at your club said, oh, are you coaching the men too?
Yeah, their question was, are you coaching both the men and the women? Yeah. And it wasn't a second thought. Actually, several of the boys, players asked me that. And I was like, no, I'm just with the women. But, you know, we all know that logistically. But, you know, and I love the men's goalkeeper coach and everything like that. But I'm just like, but I love that thought that it didn't matter. You know?
Yeah.
So. For sure. No, I think, again, to just discuss, like, my channel and discuss other content creators or even, like, U.S. Soccer when they post on YouTube. I mean, it's pretty obvious. But, like, goalkeeping for me, when you go on YouTube, there's a reason why a lot of kids are misinformed with what goalkeeping is, because they look at Manuel Neuer and there's no context to his emergency saves, right? There's no context to anything he does, the block saves that he does, the unorthodox style of play that he does. A lot of kids, if you ask them, they probably think goalkeeping is 40 yards off your line, stealing the ball and dribbling to midfield and passing to one of your teammates. That's what it is. And there is no context. And I think when it goes, it funnels down to my channel on Instagram. You think a lot of the time, for me at least, it was trial and error at first. Okay, I'm gonna go European goalkeepers, Schmeichel, Casillas, Buffon, all the big time names. And then from there, it was like, okay, then I have Tim Howard, Casey Keller, and other American goalkeepers. And then, okay, now I want to start promoting the MLS goalkeeper. So it's been like, to even get myself to get American goalkeepers respect in the USL. And in the MLS has been, it's like an uphill battle. Like, kids don't want to see American goalkeepers because they think American soccer is second class. They just don't like that.
Well, it would help if they made the World Cup. I'm sorry.
No,
I'm
true,
sorry.
True.
I'm sorry. That's the responsibility of our men's national team. If you're upset that the men are looked at as second class, then be first class. You didn't qualify for the World Cup. You lost CONCACAF. What the hell? You know,
no,
you want respect, you got to earn respect. I'm sorry.
And what I'm saying though is that, like, even though we have,
by the way, I feel like Omar's on trial. It's so great. I love this. This is the best.
I'm on your side of all this. I'm just letting you know, like, obviously, as a content creator and what I see, and if you see articles as well, there's a reason why Hope Solo, a name like that, is on a lot of like big channels, why they keep posting the exact same highlights of her over and over and over, because her name and her highlights command views. And there's a reason why, like, I'm slowly pushing the American goalkeeper, because I know I'm like slowly turning the tide now, where people are going, oh wow, maybe USL goalkeepers aren't as bad. Maybe those guys are actually who I should be looking up to. So what I'm trying to say is I'm gonna get to the point where I'm gonna be posting more of the NWSL content and more of that, because I know, like, I'm just trying to make certain things work and prove that. And then once I get to I'm getting there. It's a holistic approach and I'm getting there, but I don't post enough, and I know that, but it's a process that I'm getting to.
Well, I always remember bad press is just as good as good press.
Obviously, time to know all the goalkeepers, especially in Europe, and what's happening on male and women's side and stuff. But there's some really top female goalkeepers. One of the goalkeepers also on PSG is the Chilean goalkeeper.
She has Handler.
Fans on social media, and she's a national treasure. Literally,
she's amazing.
She's unreal.
So she keeps up your social media account quite a bit if you post on her.
No, true. But also, you guys have to remember, like, a lot of the stuff that I can't post is because of, like, copyright stuff. So, like, for example, in the World Cup, I wanted to post a bunch of stuff. I almost lost my channel this year because I posted Endler, I think she played against the U.S. when they lost 3-0. Yeah. I posted all of her highlights, and that got taken down, and I was blocked from my channel for, like, 6 days. So a lot of the reason why I post a lot of male content is because MLS and USL, it's like not free, but I can post on my Instagram channel without it being an issue. And yeah, NWSL I can as well. And I did last year. I posted a lot of Kaylin Sheridan. I posted a lot of Campbell. I forgot her first name, but different people who I posted on my channel.
Jane Campbell.
I would say it's Jamie, but yeah, Jane Campbell. Yeah.
Yeah. You did not post Jamie Campbell.
I'll go on another little rant because it dropped up in my head again. But the other day, I guess it was like national, but like World Goalkeeper Day. I don't know. You didn't know that was a thing or something. And once again, or maybe U.S. Soccer made that up. And once again, World Goalkeeper Day. And every snapshot on their site was all men's goalkeepers. And I was just like, isn't that World Goalkeeper Day or is it World Men's Goalkeeper Day? And I just shut it off. I was like, okay. Yeah.
No, but one of my heroes growing up, and I even told her, we put inside a quick story before we let you guys get back to it, but when I was 15, this is like the time when I had just gotten scouted by the Galaxy Academy, and he was at this game. We played against the women's national team, I think 2007, and we beat them. I don't know what the score was. We went to PKs. I think I saved one or two, and Brianna Scurry and Hope Solo were still like kind of going at it. And growing up, Brianna Scurry was like my hero. Like I watched her in the World Cup, obviously, and I watched her career at the NWSL whenever one of my best friends, his sisters, would come over, we'd watch the games. And I would watch them on TV, and I'd be like, she's like, I want to be like her. Like, I want to be as brave as her. I want to do this, this, and this. And then full circle, 2007, we play against them. I think Hope plays the whole game. Or I don't know what the situation was, but I think Brianna was like on she was
second.
Trending downward. Yeah, second. And I went up to her after the game, and I just want to say, I'm going to let you know, like, you're my hero. Like, you're amazing. And she's like, oh, my God, like, that means so much to me. But like even at that point, I remember like seeing her and not like I don't think she understood that I was like I was serious, like I was being dead serious, like not just because I was like in a situation where I'm in front of professional goalkeepers, but like because I really did believe that she was one of the best. And
she is.
So yeah, the more she is, that's what I'm saying. Like there are more goalkeepers than just the one that everyone always talks about in U.S. soccer, but because. It's about sensationalism in broadcasting. She's become like the face of goalkeeping on the women's side, which there's so many other goalkeepers that we're talking about in the NWSL who are the like not even just the 8 best or how many teams out of 10 now, but like
sure, look
the
at 20 Murphy.
Best
look
goal
at,
yeah 20 yeah. best goalkeepers in the world. You know what I mean? Like there's so much here, and I think the more I talk, the more I got to do my part. So I'm going to step away now and
he's going to go update his stuff. But like I said, you're in media. I was in media, everything. Sometimes bad press is just as good as good press. And, you know, when my kids come to me and I ask them to pick a goalkeeper that they wanted to, that they looked up to and everything like that, a good hand of the girls picked Hope. And I said, great, you know, hands down, straight goalkeeper on the field.
Well, but look at
on
this.
On the field. And I will say that, and anybody can come after me. She's a great goalkeeper on the field. Please don't emulate her off the field. And you can come at me, bring it. Okay? I don't care. But what I'm saying is she's a good goalkeeper, period. Absolutely. She's one of the best of all time, if not the best. I get it. Okay? And shows Bri. But I'd choose Bri any day. Sorry.
I want to talk about this because here's one thing I'm also thinking about in just regards to representation and inclusion is just a simple matter of just accessibility. And I think, you know, Omar, you bringing up the thing is about not being able to cut the clips and all that sort of thing. By the way, I think AC might be able to help you with that with PSG there. Might be able to get some Endler clips for you over there. It's just the fact is like they're all my girls in Cal South. Like I trained one yesterday. And I'm like, yeah, I can have a keeper on from PSG. You know, she's from Cal South. And they're like, there's a keeper from Cal South at PSG? It's like, that's and we talked about it. AC, it was like how hard it was, like with like Fallon. We were like trying to watch Fallon highlights, you know, here. It's like we can't get it. And so the thing is like it's a accessibility thing as well too, you know. So people need to do a better job of exposing where you can find this content too, because if people don't know where to find the content, it's going to be much more difficult to get it out there.
And Mike, one thing I would say though is that what I had said in the podcast prior, and I think it was with the TKI, we all did like a little podcast, and I was telling, I forgot her name already.
Tori Corsaro?
Yeah, I was telling Tori, I said, like, anybody who watches TKI on social media, like, take away the fact that it sucked, but like, there are people who reach out to me, like, why are you keep posting these? I don't want to say who, but people reach out to me, like, why do you keep posting TKI stuff? This is like a women's academy. We want to see men. I swear. Then I was just like, are you serious? Do you not realize that I take what you learn from me? I take things from them. Like, you don't understand. Like,
yeah, your drills come from TKI.
No, not all of them, but okay. There are some where I'm like, there's so much value in that content. And the fact that people are telling me because it's a woman's like ran thing that they're not going to watch it. And I'm like, you realize how much of an influence TKI has on the goalkeeping community, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, how many content leaders are watching their content. Like, people don't get that. They're not able to conceptualize that. And then I had to tell them, like, no, dude, watch my sessions and watch their sessions. Let me know what you think about the game realism and how they use their space and maximize their players at their sessions. And he came back to me and was like, oh, you're right. There's actually a lot of like crossover there. Like, I learn a lot more. But that's like one person who had the cojones to message me. There are a lot of people who don't have that and are thinking that. And that's where, again, the more I talk, the more I realize I got to do my part. So, again, I'm with you, and I'm going to do it. It's just
he's still you called him out so bad. This whole episode is called Call Out Omar.
Yeah, when this goes out as podcast, it's just going to be like Omar gets shut down. That's the end of the episode. No,
give him a little time to like update his site with a whole bunch more stuff.
You're going to see it now.
As this actually does get released, people are going to be like, oh, she's crazy. She's talking.
This is the next six pages. Actually, and they're all just you. They're all just highlights of you.
Yeah, right. You and Bri.
Ariana, I want to ask you, what is the situation in France? Do you meet women goalkeeper coaches out there, or is it all predominantly men?
You know, I'm like thinking now, I don't think I've seen a female goalkeeper coach. Wow. And I can totally be wrong. But I actually did look up kind of not complete stats, but I didn't want this whole thing to be like total bashing, because from when I went pro and even being, you know, kid in the States to now, there has been a lot of improvement and there has been more inclusion for women and the doors have been slightly ajar now. So I do think like things are going in the right direction. But for example, the coach of Metz here, who was in the first division, but I think they might be relegated. She's a female head coach, female. She's actually from Canada, North American. So that's even surprising that a North American is broken into the coaching. There's a second coach, Stade du Rennes, is a female coach. The CEO of Metz is a female. Might be why she hired a female coach. The LFP has a female president. The FFF has a female CEO. There's more women coaching, obviously. In the past World Cup, we saw more women out there. So I just don't want our whole podcast to be negative and bashing, because I do think the door is a little ajar for us and slowly moving forward.
Absolutely. Look at the L League starting back up again. We talked about that. The Japanese League. I played in the Japanese League. So the L League starting back up, and part of them starting back up is that 80% of their coaching staff and staff has to be female on every team. So it's part of them like women power, everything like that. They can't like staff a whole male staff. It's not going to happen. When I was there, every staff, there were no female coaches. It was all male staffs for all the teams. And now, no, they can't. That part of them qualifying and being in the L League again, they have to have female coaches, whether it's assistant coach or head coach and everything like that. But 80% of their coaching staff has to be female.
But yeah. I also think there needs to be more education, because I don't agree that the only two avenues for us after sport is to go into coaching or to like not be able to stay in. And I think that's been a misconception for so long, because daily I get asked, people are like, we know you're old, so what do you do when you're done? And my idea not to go into coaching, but I want to go into the office. I recently got an MBA actually in football. And so my idea is to be in the business world of football and run it through the office rather than from the field. I joke that I'll be out of the locker room, but I'll be in the boardroom. And I think that's where more women also need to step up, because that's going to create a change. But we need to talk about it more, or all the different positions on a football team, especially a men's professional team in Europe, in the States, all the different kinds of physical therapists, they're all the analysts that are watching video, that are cutting video, that are creating this different stuff. There's like 50 people that just go into the first team in like a Premier League club, that there's so many positions for women now that they just don't know exist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I want to shift gears for a second away from the women part, if I can for a second here. I'm a little concerned too. But this is another issue in this country, in the United States specifically, and that's the lack of a Latino inclusion in the goalkeeping world. A lot of times people will look at it as offensive or derogatory if you say that something is like the Latin game, or you know that, oh, so and so, they'll immediately, I'll have a kid or a parent say literally, and I'm this is just how horrible parents are sometimes, but they'll be like, oh, well, so and so played in Mexico, so they don't really know goalkeeping, you know, and things like that. The problem is that, again, the world is changing. The modern game is changing. We're taking bits and pieces from all over the world. We all need to recognize that we can learn from each other. How do we change this stigma? And are we changing this stigma with somebody like Omar, for instance, I hope you have some Latin guys on your page right now.
No, you know, a lot of people don't even know I'm Muslim. Like, people will DM me and be like, oh my God, you're Middle Eastern. I'm like, yep. They're like, wow. Like, a kid from Lebanon messaged me like a year and a half ago, and he said, I don't know if he was just on Google Translate, but he was like, it's an honor for our country to have someone like you. And I was just like, okay, cool. I don't know if that's Google Translate or if you actually mean that, or you're just trying to get a shout out. I don't know what it is, but I was like, that's cool. Like, I mean, that means a lot to me, but that was awesome.
Yeah. Well, I was talking about more of your Hispanic heritage as well.
Oh, sorry. I'm going to tell you a quick story and then I'll let you guys go. But my goalkeeper coach of the Galaxy, he saw the tendencies that I had, because my uncle played in Mexico and he was a goalkeeper. And he came back around the same time I was getting like more and more at the higher levels. And so he was teaching me all the Hispanic, like, drop both knees, make your body, like they call it the Jesus Cristo, like turn your body, make yourself like wide, and let the ball hit you in the chest, like being brave, but very non-American and non-European. And there was a few sessions early on where the ball was coming down and I dropped down to both knees and I scooped the ball up. And he said, Omar, you know, I see a lot of Mexican tendencies and I'm just really curious. Do you know how many goalkeepers, Mexican goalkeepers, are in the Premier League? And I was like, probably none, honestly, I don't know. He's like, how many American goalkeepers are there in the Premier League? And I was like, probably like a handful, a good amount. And he's like, well, then I want you to tell me which way is the right way. And ever since then, I was just like, I was 15 and I was like easily kind of persuaded. And I was like, damn, you're right. I should probably not do that anymore. And now that I'm becoming...
We've discussed that. You can take bits and pieces from everything as long as you perfect it and make it work. And so if there's a certain style that's a Mexican style or, you know, South American style, and you perfect that, like the whatever it's called.
Oh, the Danish. Danish. AAC, have you seen this? The Danish catch?
The Danish catch. If you perfect it, like, and if it's part of your game and you take other parts of the American style, the Danish style, the English style, and you perfect what you have to perfect to make yourself a great goalkeeper, then I don't have the right as a goalkeeper coach to say, there are no Mexicans in the English league, so why are you playing like that? No, that's a bad coach. That's a bad coach. That's like, why don't we take that, what you're doing really well with that, and why don't we like adapt it and tweak it? And add it to your repertoire.
A lot of it is it's just like, you know, that such a statement like that is just so ignorant, because the fact is like, just because somebody's not playing over there doesn't mean that they didn't have the ability to. They might have never had the resources. They never had the opportunities, the right coaching. But they had the ability and they just never were able to get over there. You know,
But on the same time, it might be on the stigma of the EPL. Are they going down to South America and are they looking for keepers?
Yeah.
You know, or are they so stuck in their ways that maybe we'll take some from America, but we're going to look in Europe first?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, but I think that also comes down to finances. Sorry, it's the other side of looking at it from the game.
No, absolutely.
That's why we have you here. You're like business person.
If you're in English Premier League, though, the fact that you could actually bring an American goalkeeper into your league is big business. That's what it is. You're going to have sponsors coming in from the United States that are going to put their name across your jersey for millions and millions of dollars a year because you actually have an American on your team and you can promote this. That's why you're seeing more and more Asian players coming over into
the Premier League.
And they're promoting it. And unfortunately, Mexico isn't a market that the English Premier League wants to promote. And South America doesn't have the finances, even though in some ways they really do. They just don't see that economy as big business. There's also a huge business in the English Premier League, in Portugal, in Spain, in France, in Italy, on tourism, that you know that you can sell higher price tickets to foreigners who come to the games and Americans travel. So it's better business to bring an American goalkeeper onto your team.
Well, absolutely. And you have American owners, you have Asian owners of teams in the EPL. You have television deals that you could see more EPL games here than you could see MLS games, you know, and they're on NBC every weekend and the MLS isn't. So it's like, yes, absolutely. I 100% agree with you. Well,
across Manchester United, and I don't think they don't sell Chevys in England.
No way. Seriously?
Good point. I think it's Opel.
Oh my gosh.
It's under a different brand name, but you're correct.
Oh. If that you're being sold, like you can't.
It's Chevy. Right.
Ariana, that's like a drop the mic type.
Yeah, it's like, okay.
Sound bite right there, like boom, and I'm done. I think we lost Omar. Is Omar still there?
No, I'm still here.
Okay.
No, you make a really good point. And like what is so frustrating, to be honest though, is that the side volley, people think it originated, God knows, in England or wherever they think it originated from because of social media. And the block save, it originated in Europe, when really the same things that coaches were frowning upon 10, 15, 20 years ago has now come to the forefront. And I'm trying to do my part, at least, to tell people, like, this has been something that was in Latin America for years and years and years. I told a story on here once that I trained in Mexico with Tecos, and they literally had a drill where the coach would shoot the ball and like try and make me catch it. I would be the one starting the drill by side volleying the ball to the corner of like the midline. And then from there, they would come down and do a crossing exercise. That was how like pertinent and how like ingrained in the team setting that was. So now people are doing it and you see young kids trying to do it and doing all this stuff. And I'm like, guys, this has been around for years. Like, why are you all of a sudden now it's cool because the European guys are saying that it's okay that you guys can do it, or the American coaches are coming around and realizing, yeah, go for it. Because now it's in the subconscious of people and goalkeeping people in the United States. And that's a wrong. And then you see Ederson, you see Allison and those guys who are getting the chances now because the game has come full circle and has become a modern game of playing with your feet. And these goalkeepers have been doing it for hundreds of years. And now they're the ones who are coming to the forefront as the ones who are getting pushed in, and Joe Hart's getting pushed out.
I want to talk about this, though, Omar. You brought up a really good point in regards to the side volley and taking little bits and pieces. But here's my issue with that, is that isn't that just a form of appropriation? It's like, okay, cool, we'll just take that, but we're never going to hire a Mexican goalkeeper coach. We're never going to hire, you know, a women's coach for a team.
Don't get me started with that.
You get what I'm saying? But yeah, we'll take ideas from them, and then we'll just use them as our own. Like, isn't that kind of a form of appropriation? I'm asking anybody here.
But there are things, though, like there are Hispanic coaches who I know that their style of coaching would never fly here. Like, that's the thing, though, is that, like, it depends on who's at the top. If you have, let's say, for example, Pep Guardiola, I mean, he's obviously has his methodologies, and he's Spanish and where he's from. He has a Spanish goalkeeper coach. And I was listening to a podcast with Joe Hart and Richard Wright recently. And they were talking about how when they came in, they had a Spanish a goalkeeper coach with, I think it was Pellegrini, I forget his name, but they had a Spanish goalkeeper coach with him, and it was completely different. It was a new style, middle of their careers, learning like a South American style, like a Spanish, like different type of European style that they were having to like work with. So from the top down, if you're open and you feel like a Hispanic way of goalkeeping is the right way to go, they're going to hire someone Hispanic.
Yeah, but you know what I mean? But I think we've talked about, like, at a certain level, are you really hiring somebody to change Joe Hart's form? Like,
no,
you're
absolutely
a Spanish
not.
Goalkeeper coach in, and all of a sudden teaching him how to do the K-save or whatever like that, or like different stuff. No, you're there to maintain and enhance like little things. If you have a Spanish goalkeeper on the team that's already got that style and that's what you're looking for to enhance, then yes, probably it fits. Like, I don't think anybody should come in at that level and try to be like, well, you know, this is how we do it, so we're going to totally change what you're doing. Because at 35 years old, you know, you're kind of set. I mean, like we talked about, other than working on maybe like positioning and stuff like that, you're really probably not going to change his style.
Yeah,
other than
I agree.
Screw it up.
Ariana, you're still playing. I mean, I pretend that I play. I tell people I play. I still, you know, in my mind, I play. I still play a lot of solid center and aside. Anyway, you're still playing. Do you feel that's difficult as an older goalkeeper, learning a new style or having somebody try to, you know, have you adjust something? If you're going to see it be successful for you, are you willing to give it a shot?
So I've tried a couple of things. The most recent, I don't know, it's actually kind of funny to bring this up. I don't know what the name is. We don't really use names all the time. But you know, when you come out of it, like if you dive and then you spin your body to jump up in the opposite way rather than just like throw your legs
spin,
up?
Yeah.
I just call it the spin move.
The spin technique, yeah.
Yeah.
Spin technique? Yeah, that's a newer technique for me personally. It's not I'd ever been trained to do, especially at a younger age. So even a couple years ago, they tried to throw it in my game. It was like, okay, it's just not happening. I'm not going to spend hours and get slow trying to do that than like popping up. And so even this year, though, we had some extra time with my goalkeeper coach. I'm like, you know, I just for some giggles, let's try this. It was so hard and so frustrating that no, I don't think it was like, I mean, I'll probably keep maybe trying to do it just so I can do it. But I'm so set in the way I've done it for so many years that to try to do that. Actual game setting or like 5v5 when we're playing small-sided, I'd get scored on. There'd be no time for me to let myself and think about that and get my brain down to my, no, there's no way. So
and like as a kid coach for club, like for younger kids, I'll give them the option. You know, if they're struggling with just like, you know, just kicking up, which I do as well, because I feel like it's an immediate way to have your body weight forward and on the balls of your feet. But I'll give them the option, try this and try that and see what you can perfect. Again, see which technique works best for you. And that's what we'll adapt. But if somebody came to me at 35 and said, at 30 and said, hey.
No, I am 35. You're right the first time.
Okay. It was just a number. And said, okay, let's try to change this. I'd be like, yeah, it's not going to happen. You know, because it would mess up with my rhythm that I've been doing for 30 years. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's just like.
Exactly. But there's small tweaks that my goalkeeper coach this year has tried to instill, or a little change, or even watching the two other goalkeepers that are on the team with me. They both have completely different styles. They come from different countries and different backgrounds. So it's also great kind of watching them. And there's small tweaks that I think you can change that can maybe make a big difference. But a whole move is really difficult, in my opinion.
Yeah, me too.
I want to say this though, you know, one thing that that's really fascinating to me is that us all having this discussion right here. And by the way, I like the fact that sometimes, you know, Ariana going after Omar and stuff like that. Like I you know, and I'm not just trying to throw shade at Omar, but I like these types of conversations and dialogues. I think that's the only way it's going to keep growing, or we're going to be able to keep getting more honest and vulnerable about what we still need to put work into. And so I want to talk about the fact that, like, with all the different things that we're all doing here in the goalkeeping community, are we role models? Are we making a difference? Or are we just following the status quo? I mean, personally, I don't want to, you know, just say that I think I'm a trendsetter or anything like that. I think I've got so much forward to grow still. There's just so much more to grow. But then again, I'm not writing amazing articles like Ariana. So, you know.
I think for any coach or for any athlete to say that they're not a role model in the wrong business. I think that it's a ridiculous statement, even when Charles Barkley said it. I think that it's you are looked up to regardless from kids, from peers, and everything like that. And we've had the gift of playing at high levels and the highest level, and that's part of what you take on. And if you take on the fact that you're going to have a forum, like a podcast, and talk to people, and you're going to take on the fact that you're a coach of a club and a university, or you're playing pro, and you turn to me and say, I'm not a role model, then you're in the wrong business and get out of it. Because then you're selfish as hell, and it's all about you. You know, we are in the job of promoting our sport, having positive role models for kids to look up to and emulate. And so that's part of the game. Yeah, it's part of the game, period.
Yeah. So I will actually go against what you say, Saskia.
All right.
I love it. I love it. Look at this debate.
I mean, there's a certain part of what you say that I do believe, but also recently in another chat that I was talking to, some university kids asked me if we have a responsibility to give back or like within that to be a role model. For me, I don't look at myself as a role model. I don't like look in the mirror, walk past and be like, role model. Yeah.
No.
Yes. I realize that probably people do look up to me, but I don't pay attention to what I do because children are looking up to me. I pay attention because for me, it's a moral right to do what I do and to be good at it, or to show that women can go into the boardroom now, to show that I can be on the field and after practice, I can go in the boardroom and try to make a difference in what's happening. But I don't think that any player has that responsibility. And for some players, that's a huge responsibility on their shoulders that they don't know how to deal with. And it's very difficult. And I don't think players have to be the most like go lucky. Some players are really shy. They're really timid in front of the camera, things like this. But I do think if there's a child on the sideline who's asking for the autograph, they should go over there.
Thank you. And I agree with you. I don't expect everybody to wave a flag and be on the top of a podium or a soapbox. And absolutely, there are people that are very shy and that just want to put their head down and play. But I think, yes, there is a moral obligation when you're on the field and there's a child on the sideline. And I've heard plenty of stories of players that have said legitimately on the female side, hey, I'm not going to sign that jersey after a game because this isn't my name on the back. And what is that? Like, you know, we have a certain, you know, I know you're shy. I know this. And I'm not asking you to pick up the microphone. I'm not asking you to do that. But I'm asking you to hold yourself to a certain standard. And any player that I played with and any player that I'd want to play with should hold themselves to a baseline standard. And we can deal with it from there. You know, and look, they're incredibly shy people over history. Christine Lilly was shy. Mia Hamm was actually really shy. You know, but some people have to pick up those torches more than others. But at least, you know, have some pride. I'm sorry, have some pride.
No, that part, I absolutely totally agree with. And I think teams need to step up and do a better job of media training, because you do still need to be able to, when you're walking off the field and you're asked a question, you need to be able to respond to it well, with good words in the correct language, and then keep walking, like a small just sound bite. But and a lot of people just walk past, and I played with so many girls who just walk past, like, I don't have to do that. And I'm like, we're not there yet. We have not arrived.
Thank you.
And even most of the men are still words that I probably can't say on this podcast that should be stopping anyways, because you make too much damn money, and especially coming out of COVID-19, if you have the like amazing privilege to do what you love every day and to make a living, and for most people not just a living but a very high living, you really need to respect those people that are paying to watch your games
and paying for your jerseys and buying the tickets and, you know, and everything else. And absolutely, and do I expect you to sit out there for an hour? But I expect you to have some respect. You know, you have to give respect to get respect, and do, like I said, I don't expect everybody to pick up the mic and stuff, but I think there's a certain level that we're all responsible.
Omar, I know that obviously, you know, you put in a lot of work, and we talked about it earlier in regards to you give a lot of free content out there. And there's been a lot of people that have told you need to be charging for all this content. But you've always said the reason that you do it free is because there are those kids like that kid in Lebanon. You know, you don't know where their background is. You know, when he says something like, you're a hero to me, or your honor, or whatever, that type of thing. It's like, you don't recognize the people that you're affecting by allowing that content to live out there.
Yeah. The people who have told me, yeah, you should be charging. And I don't know, I'm not a business person, or I don't know what it is, but I just think that from a business perspective, you can really grow a lot more and really grow the brand if it's like more selfless work where you're just putting out free content and anybody from anywhere in the world can learn. versus you have to have a socioeconomic like background to be able, or you know, enough to purchase a subscription to my channel. I don't want to do that. I just feel like I'll really limit the people that I could reach and the people that I could affect. And as a young kid, I mean, I never really talked to my parents about this stuff, but I would be on YouTube and I'm watching like highlights, I'm watching this, I'm watching that. I'd have them call and buy me DVDs. So I was always like super curious. So for anybody who was like me out there, that's super curious, I don't want to make them have to go through obstacles to find content. I want it to be as straightforward, as easy as possible. Go on YouTube, go on Instagram. I'm not on TikTok yet. Well, I am, but not like, not educational content, but the most part, the most, and on Facebook too. So the most part is for me is just getting my name out there. And
how do we do it inside the 18 on TikTok? I'm just trying to think in six seconds.
It'd be like quick clips.
It'd quick be clips us of yelling, sauce at, yeah.
It'd be us yelling at Omar and then that's it.
Yeah, but no, I think that's the beauty of it all. It was like, I've been able to create a lot of networking opportunities. And I mean, I'm sitting here with a 99er, you know what I mean? Like that doesn't happen. I'm saying it doesn't happen unless I put more and more content out there. Somebody sees it, a young kid or a coach sees it and goes, thank you so much for this. I appreciate it. And because of that, that elevates my platform little by little by little. And it helps me out. And especially the quarantine time where I've been able to interview top coaches because they see the value of my platform. Versus what if I had gone the algorithm way and tried to just post only viral content? Those same people, I guarantee you, Sasuke would be like, I've seen that guy's stuff. There's no way. Like, I can't associate my brand with that. And I think that is what I think a lot of brand creators and people at the higher levels who have those platforms need to understand. Like you guys talking about, when you're walking by young kids without signing their autograph, you don't know who those kids are and what they're going to grow up to be, you know what I mean? And you don't know if you giving them the 2 seconds of you know, signing a jersey, they might go, oh my God, I asked somebody who was higher than me for an autograph and they said yes. Wow, my confidence just went through the roof. And you don't know what their confidence, where it's going to go from there. So I think it's just important for everybody who has those platforms to do their part and to really step up to the plate, because everything you've ever wanted and asked for before you started your journey has come to fruition now. And now it's about you taking those opportunities that you have always wished for.
No, absolutely. And one of the things I'm proud of in the quarantine right now is I've gotten these opportunities I wouldn't get. Like, I'm supposed to go in for an elementary school on Monday. It doesn't have anything to do with soccer. It's just going to talk to these kids. They're doing a project, and I'm popping in on a Zoom call. You know, I have calls with, like, other clubs from around the country just to pop in because they were analyzing the 99 final or something. I'm not sitting there going, okay, here's my Venmo, send me. You know, like, I'm sorry, where are we right now? Nobody's working and stuff like that. I would be a total asshole to do that.
Speaking of that, it's at Michael-Magid on.
You know, but it's true. Like, we have to, there are certain things, like.
Yeah, but I think also too, in some ways, it's also like the American pay-to-play model that people are so used to paying for, like, soccer or anything to do with soccer. I actually have a friend in Southern California. Her daughter's six, seven. She's paying a girl $20 for 15 minutes of training online.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
But see, shame on the girl. Because, and look, trust me, I could tell you right now, look, yes, I'm still getting paid by my club, and I have I have training online and all of that. But at the same time, like Michael and stuff, like, 20 minutes, like 15 minutes? Come on, man. You know?
I mean, look.
You don't know if these parents are out of work. You don't know what's going on.
I'll be straight up honest into this. And one of the reasons I like with, you know, and I'm not trying to plug what we're doing right now, but like with the virtual training that, you know, LA Goalkeeping Academy is doing right now, you know, private and group trainings, there's a free demo on front. No, I'm trying. Okay. I'm trying to provide an actual resource that they're not getting out there right now. I see a lot of individual training sessions, like you're on 15 minutes, $20 for 15 minutes of individual skill work. I miss goalkeeper training. I miss actually doing goalkeeper training. And so what I'm trying to do when I do a virtual session is I'm trying to replicate a real goalkeeper training session. And I'll go past the time if I don't feel the session's there yet. And because the number one responsibility, I think, is the client and that kid and them getting better in the long run. That's why you do it. Why? Because you're a teacher and you're an educator, you know? And unfortunately,
I mean, on the flip side though, the person might be struggling a lot at this time and really only made money from privates or something. So maybe the person.
Yeah, that's true.
Look, Look, I get that. I get that as well. I get it that, like, I can't judge you because that might have been your only source of income and you're trying to find a way to put food on your table. Absolutely. So I don't mean to come across as, like, you're wrong, you're doing the wrong thing.
Well, in that case, if there's a 20%
discount. No, everybody's an individual, you know?
But my point, though, is, like, that wouldn't, like, that doesn't exist here. At least I haven't seen it. Nobody here in France would pay for it. It just doesn't, because growing up in the academy system and stuff, the club pays you basically, even like, you know, 15, 16, you can already sign a contract. And even now youth girls are signing contracts. They're being paid to move from their house to the academies. And so that idea just isn't here.
Do you have any young pros in the goalkeeping program over there? You see?
Yeah. PSG? Off of our youth team, our goalkeeper she's really good. Actually, she'll be training with the first team next year for sure. She'll still play with the youth, but she'll be definitely training with the first team.
That's awesome. Well, guys, we've gone over an hour.
We
and
can
20.
Keep going.
I know. We could literally keep going. And honestly, this has been like one of my favorite episodes. And I know I joke around when I say, well, every one of them is my favorite. But like, this is actually one of my favorites because we've really gotten into a profound, difficult discussion. That, you know, it does have to do with goalkeeping, but it doesn't have to do with goalkeeping. It has to do with a lot more than just goalkeeping. And we're using the casing of goalkeeping to showcase, you know, some things that still need to be addressed out there. Anybody out there, for instance, Ariana, like you're moving on into the office side of things and into the exec side of things.
See, you're going to be a GM one day.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're going to be in her, you know, we're going to be trying to get in her
PSG, not just PSG women.
Let's just get
Leonardo.
Let's get
no, don't do that.
We'll try to
edit that.
Can we get into one of those boxes? That'll be one day. That'll be a pretty solid. But do you have any advice to anyone who's coming from a non-traditional background? You know, who's embarking in kind of like a leadership position, a front office position? You know, that you wish you had gotten. You know, when you were going into this.
I mean, I don't necessarily think it has to go to a non-traditional, because I was thinking about this for a little bit, and I think even the people that we're not talking about, white middle-class men or something like that, I think everybody has their own personal struggle, and nothing is easy for anybody. Everybody goes through certain things. So I think my biggest thing, and when it comes to, which is why I think goalkeepers are a certain way, and they're actually more successful overseas, is just confidence. It's learning as much as you can so that you're more confident when you go into a boardroom, so that you're more confident when you're having a discussion. A goalkeeper asked me about the mental game, training. The more training you do, the more comfortable I think you are in a game, because you know that you've done the work. And I think that's the same thing going into any leadership position. If you do the work and you study, you'll feel more comfortable and you'll be better at your job.
I think you couldn't have said any better in regards to the confidence factor. I think that's, we talk about it all the time, and it's something that I need to work on too. I understand that there's certain fields that when I don't feel that I know what I'm talking about, I lose that confidence, and I notice it right away. It's also the same thing as, like, I have the confidence on this microphone to be talking to literally anybody, you know, even someone as high stature as yourself, you know, on the show right now. And still feel comfortable discussing things. But Saskia, Omar, anything you guys want to add before we wrap this up?
Yeah. No, I could talk with Ariana forever. I love it.
Well, you guys will have to exchange numbers, and you guys. Oh my gosh! Hold on, wait! You're gonna come back here? What? You're coming back down.
I tell a story about Saskia because it, like,
really.
Oh, here we go! Yes, yes. Yes, okay. Please.
Oh, God, there's a story about me. That's
I remember the 99 World Cup was a pretty big deal because I was from SoCal, so that final came to the Rose Bowl. I was in the stands. I got Julie Foudy shin guard, and I can't remember what I'm talking about. Somebody else's cleat. Like, I was in the second row.
Oh, you were racking it up.
But there was a game before that was played on TV. I don't remember who you guys were playing, and you guys must have won tightly. Because you were sitting on the bench, but you jumped up with your dyed hair and you were going crazy off the bench because you guys won the game.
And you were wait, like, a bit going. We played Brazil before that. Okay, go ahead.
But I just remember looking at that, and my first response was like, why is she so happy she didn't play?
Are you kidding?
Yeah, no. So that was like my first. The more I've grown and the more I've understood, the more I appreciate that image, because you were happier than almost anybody that was actually on the field.
Yeah.
Looking back into it, that everybody forgets, and it's actually something that I feel like you guys have talked about in some of your other episodes, where everybody wants to play so bad that they forget how important the whole team is, and that it took the whole team to get there, and it took you pushing your players and pushing Bree and really engaging as a whole team, that you absolutely deserve to be as happy as you freaking wanted jumping off that bench. And it bothers me now when I see people who comment, well, like, you weren't on the field, so what does it matter? Or you weren't even on the roster that day, you were in the stands. But you train every day and you put in just as much blood, sweat, and tears as everybody else, mm-hmm. physically, that 11 on the field. And that was something, though, that really stuck with me. So
I love that.
Enthusiasm, passion, jumping off that bench was awesome.
I love that. Thank you. Because that was, well, was one of the reasons we won the World Cup, because everybody on that bench supported everybody else. And I'll tell you a quick story. When we were playing against Germany and we were down 2-1 at halftime. And the team went in, and the energy from the team was in the dirt. And it was quarterfinals. If we lost the game in DC, that would have been it. We would have been out. And we all stayed on the field, the reserves, the game changers, as Jill likes to call it, which I like that a lot better. And Tish brought us all together. And she said, guys, listen, we got to change the team's energy. It's up to us. When they walk out of that tunnel for the second half, we're going to be right there. And we're going to be so stoked. And we're going to be so amped. And we're going to be so positive. But the minute they walk on that field, they're going to feel that energy. And we did that. And they came out, we're like, yeah, we got this. High-fived everybody, like, totally, like positive, positive, positive. And if you talk to Fowdy, and if you talk to guys like Brandy and those guys now, they never forgot that moment. They said, we were so stressed. Germany was kicking our butt. And when we came out and we saw the reaction of our reserves, that it changed our whole mentality the minute we walked onto the field. And then Shannon McMillan came in and shot that corner kick that Joy hit in, and then Brandy scored, you know, after she had hit the own goal, and it was like we won the game. But they said that changed everything. Every single player on that team had a responsibility and a role. And whether it was in practice or on the field or on the bench, that's why we won the World Cup, period. But I love that that's what you remember, and that makes me so proud, and thank you.
Ariana, if you could share your first your memory of Omar Zini and when you saw him at honestly, we're all gonna have to get together when you come back out here for sure. Maybe Omar can train you and put you on the site.
I have a feeling that the next four pages of the site are gonna be all women.
Then we've done our job here.
Yes.
Inclusion has happened.
If anybody wants to reach out to you, you're obviously very active on social media, and I love the fact that you're, you know, willing to speak your mind and speak your voice, because there are a lot of athletes out there that feel uncomfortable, you know, speaking their voice, and you're not. So where's the best place for people to reach out to you?
Instagram, mostly on Instagram. So AC Footballer, send me a message, and if I look into that part, I will hopefully be able to answer it for you. And reach out, no problem. Lots of time right now.
and Omar, if you've got any questions on why Omar doesn't have any women's players on in the last 3 or 4 weeks.
Yeah, you guys should reach out to me on there too.
You make so many more female followers now. They're just trying to check.
He's like, I gotta get off here. I gotta update it right now.
No, to be honest with you, this is a conversation Omar and I have had in the past. Anyway, this should be edited. Anyway. All right. And if you want to reach out to Saskia, and you got more stories to share about seeing her jump up and down with her dyed hair, it's Instagram @Saskia_Weber, right?
Yeah, bring it on.
Awesome. Cool, guys. And if you have a guest suggestion or a topic suggestion for Inside the 18, it's contact@InsideThe18. That's the number 18media.com. Or you can reach out to us @GoalkeeperPodcast. Also, keep rating, reviewing, and subscribing, because we even get players from PSG that review us. So what are you doing? Why are you not reviewing? All right, guys, that's all the time on Inside the 18. This has been fantastic. We're out, and let me end this stream.
Bye, guys.
Guys, this was really good.
That was awesome.
AC, when do you know when you're going to be coming back?
No, because we're technically furloughed right now.
Really?
Yeah, and the team, it's kind of weird because nobody's talking about it, but actually all of France, football is furloughed. So if you actually check social media, most French clubs aren't doing anything because they're not legally allowed to.
Really?
So really taking over that space. Nothing on our thing is really new content because they're not allowed to request us to work, and that's considered work. They're also not allowed to send us programs technically because that's work. So they're talking about bringing us back in like beginning or mid-June. So I don't know. And if we do that, then we're supposed to go through the season. But I for personal reasons, I need to come home for at least a week. So hopefully I'll get back in July. But I also have to decide if I'm going to re-sign a contract or not. So depending on that too.
A lot of decisions.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot. Well, when you do make it out to here, or when we are allowed to finally get travel to France, man, there's all these cool places I want to go, and it's like every time we meet all these people from all over the world, and then these things happen. So, but yeah, on the positive is this isn't going to be forever.
It'll finally break hopefully.
All right, I'm gonna bounce. Ariane, right. Thank you. It was awesome. And
thank you.
That story was awesome. Thanks. Sometimes I forget about that stuff.
Yeah. I'll share.
That's awesome.
Saskia, I'll share your info with Ariana. Yeah. So you guys can stay in touch.
All right. Bye, guys. Omar, wake up. Bye.
Sorry,
wake up.
All
right. We'll talk to you guys later.
Call you out like that, but it was just a really good example within the
it was a great example.
No, it was great within the context. It was actually great because it was organic right there in the moment. So I liked it. Yeah.
It's all good, Norris.
All right.
It's all good.
All right. See you guys later.
See you guys. Take care.
Bye. Bye.